Hello world, welcome back to my channel. I'm a former biomedical engineering grad student and I'm currently working at a healthcare clinical lab. And in this channel, I share my academics, career, and life here in the US. I think many of my subscribers got to know me a little bit through my video, The Day in the Life as a Biomedical Engineering Grad Student. And I'm very happy to have received many comments that it's helpful to you. And in today's video, I want to talk a little bit more about how a biomedical engineering grad program normally goes here in the US and how it actually went for me. And most importantly, the lessons and mistakes you can take away from this video so as to help you prepare more for your own program. I've paid my fair share to learn these mistakes so that you don't have to. And as always, if you find this video helpful, please consider like and subscribe so that this video can reach more aspiring students like yourself. Now let's get right to it. And from now on, I'm going to refer biomedical engineering as BME. First, let's talk about the different types of BME master degrees. The following content is more specifically applied to my own grad program, but I think it's generally pretty common across the US as I have browsed through and applied to many before accepting this offer. There are generally four types of BME master's degree. The first one is accelerated program. So if you are already a BME student in undergrad, I think some schools offer like accelerated programs where students can get both of their bachelor's and master's degrees in about 5 years, aka 4+1 programs. The rest of the degree types are more traditional grad school programs where students can apply to different schools with or without a relevant undergrad background. These include a coursework path, thesis path, and or certification. Generally, the two most common pathways to get your BME master degree is either a thesis-based or coursework-based. Some schools may have a third one, like a certification or specification, and I actually don't know too much about it. So the coursework path is pretty self-explanatory, which is you will get the degree after you've completed all the required courses. And this is an example of a coursework path. A thesis path is generally more common or it's more recommended by your advisors. If you are not already on your path to getting a PhD degree, a thesis path serves as a better stepping stone to a PhD program. And up to this point, I've concluded all the common pathways to get a BME master's degree. And as you can see here, some of the example classes include like experimental design and data analysis in BME. There's master's thesis. There are also medical product development, regulatory pathways for medical product development, scientific communications, biomaterials, tissue engineering, cellular engineering, drug delivery, and such. Okay, now let's talk about the BME grad program timeline. The length of a master's program is generally 2 years, 4 semesters, or 6 semesters if you include summers. Now let's focus on talking about the thesis timeline today. An ideal roadmap would look something like this. From the first semester to the end of the summer, or even latest to the end of the first year, it involves taking introductory classes and lab rotation, and for our department, the first year students can start shadowing their assigned mentors and start working in the lab. And from the second semester to the end of the second year is generally the most stressful time of a grad program, where you would first have to decide on what project you want to work on and then write a thesis proposal about it. This proposal is just to tell your committee members that what projects you plan to work on and how would it make a difference, how you would design and perform your experiments, how you plan to collect and analyze the results. And this stage usually goes a little back and forth between you and your committee members to make sure your plan actually makes sense. after your proposal is approved by your committee members, and of course, you would then start doing your experiments and troubleshoot what's not working and how to make things work. And then you would collect and analyze your result. And after that, you would put everything together as your thesis work. And at last, you would defend your thesis, which is just a fancy way to say, give a presentation of your entire work of the grad school program to your committee members and maybe some of the other department people and answer their questions. If you still remember that I mentioned that this is an ideal roadmap, and next I'm gonna go over what's the exact real case scenario for myself, and as you may have guessed, it's not exactly ideal. And not ideal is exactly the real cases for many, many graduates out there because it's just so common to have many unexpected things to happen during your grad program. Things like it takes a very long time to decide what you want to work on, and you may change advisor and have to start all over, or your advisor is leaving, such and such. So flashing back 2 years ago, I started my first semester in August 2020, and if you remembered, it was exactly the time when COVID was at its peak. So our department's lab were shut down because of that, and probably not a good time to start a grad program. Anyways, our school went hybrid for the first year, and the first semester for me was just taking classes. So I took classes like introductory to BME, biomaterials, and some other ones. And second semester was kind of the same, so taking more classes. Not until May or June of 2021 did the lab start to open up again, and I was assigned to write a part of the review paper about vascular tissue engineering with my PhD mentor and start to figure out what project I want to do for my thesis. So most of my days were filled with reading papers, organizing information, slowly putting together my part of the paper. And in the meantime, I shadowed my PhD mentor and started to do some lab work such as cell culture, animal tissue harvesting, using some of the instruments, etc. I was then about like 1 year into the program, but I still didn't know what to do for my thesis. And I think it was around fall of 2021, I finally decided on a project that I was interested in doing for my thesis, which was using a biomaterial blend to fabricate artificial vascular tissues. And please watch this video if you're curious about how my day-to-day lab life was like. And for a good few months, I was just kind of doing the same thing every day, like making more samples, validate them, test them, collect data, trying to understand the data. And not until later did I find out that this project was actually not my supervisor's project. It was actually my PhD mentor's project. I'm not trying to say anything about my PhD mentor. He's a very intelligent person. But the problem here is that when this project is not my supervisor's project, I feel like I just didn't get enough technical support in the project because this area was not necessarily his specialty. I guess you may wanna say that I should have found this out earlier. True, I should have really asked myself these hard questions early on into the program, which I will include that in my mistake lessons later on. Also, what I would like to add to that is since this PhD mentor is working under my supervisor, so I just naturally assumed that they were working on this project together. And to complicate things even more, so the funding of this project actually came from another professor, and this project was agreed to be supervised by my supervisor at the time later on. And it's exactly these unexpected events that result in graduation timeline delay and adding extra stress to a grad program. And for the course of the biomaterial project, I kept getting inconsistent data that I couldn't explain, and some of the experiments just didn't work out. And at this time, I didn't have enough time to fix any major experimental designs. And eventually, my advisor had to revise my original proposal to try something new, which means starting all over for some of the experiments. And to make things even worse, so some of the lab supplies got really low and some of them even ran out. And due to the supply chain problem caused by COVID, it's either out of stock for many suppliers or it took a few months to be shipped and delivered. I felt extremely pressured that I had to cram everything together in such a short time, and eventually, bearing so much pressure, I just decided to switch to a course-based path completely, which, you know, my advisor got really mad at me that I gave up at this point, or that he has invested so much time and effort in this project. I mean, he had all the reasons to be mad, but at that moment, I just thought that my health and my mental health were the most important things that I didn't want to lose. Okay, now we've come to my mistake lessons part. Instead of blaming everything on COVID, I think there are indeed a few things to take away from my personal experience. The first point is I took way too much time to decide on what project I want to work on for my thesis, which resulted in me running out of time later into the project, and definitely a lot less time to troubleshoot experiments that didn't work out. So just be aware how fast time flies, and the earlier you can decide on a project and get approved and start working on it, the less stress you would be later on into the program. And you would definitely have a lot more time buffer to fix unexpected errors. So the second mistake is that if you don't have any idea on what project you want to work on, try to get more information on what current, and make sure it's current projects your advisor, if you have already decided on working under one, because if they are currently and actively working on something, they would have a much better idea on what you can immediately work on. Otherwise, you'll need to spend a lot more time to figure that out for yourself. And if you have not decided on any advisor to work under, then try to figure out what projects the rest of your department faculty members are actively working on, in case you need to switch to a different advisor later on, which is not that uncommon. Also, another thing is that I think this may apply to a smaller department, but I may be wrong. So not every faculty member is actively and currently working on research projects, and some of the faculty members could be just mainly focusing on teaching classes, so that they may have less time for advising graduates. So have these conversations with them as early as possible. I guess the best time would be at the interview, and the second best time would be earlier into the program. So the third point is also relevant to communication. I would advise that you try to find out who would be your graduate committee members as early as possible, maybe at the end of the first semester or latest the first year, because these are the most important people for your project, because they will approve your proposal and be eventually approve your graduate thesis if you're doing a thesis. So once you have some idea on what you want to work on, ask these people for directions, for feedbacks, ask more specific questions as possible. And last but not least, your advisor may tell you that thesis is the way to go, and they may even pressure you that you have disappointed them because the decision you made is out of their expectation. But you know, something is just not for everybody. If you found out that something is not for you halfway or even nearing the end of your program, you just need to be brave enough to do what's best for yourself. And I definitely know that this is not easy, but it's completely, totally, definitely okay to say, no, that is not for me, instead of suffering it all through. What can be even worse than losing your own health and your mental health? And now I'm looking back 6 months later on the toughest decision I had to make at the time. Hard feelings will pass, you know? And guess what? After so many interviews, almost no employer cared if I even done a thesis or not. So remember, do what's best for you. And just a brief recap here, in this video, I talked about the common grad school degree types, how an ideal grad school timeline looks like, and how BME grad program actually went for me. And lastly, the costly mistakes for you to take away from my experience. And please feel free to comment below if you have other questions. And like always, if you find this video helpful, please consider like and subscribe so that it helps more people like yourself. And good luck to grad school, and I'll see you next time.